Good morning and praise the Lord, everyone. I wish you a very happy Resurrection Sunday. It's so nice to see you all. One second, So today, when I came to know that I would be sharing the message on the Resurrection Sunday, I was wondering, dear God, what can I share with your people today? I mean, we've been listening to the Resurrection Day messages since our childhood. Message of hope. And I was wondering, what different message can I share? And I was praying and waiting for God to tell me, what is His word for His people today? What does the message of resurrection of Jesus Christ has to say to us in the midst of this pandemic, terror, chaos, uncertainties, violence, sickness? I mean, what does it have to say? But then it all came to me. The message of resurrection is simple and clear. Christ is risen. He is alive. The power of sin and death have been defeated. And as the angel of God said in Mark chapter 16, verse 5 to 7, the risen Christ goes before us to lead the way in this broken world. The message of hope has always been the same. It was relevant then, and it is even more relevant now. Now, ever since the pandemic struck, every aspect of our world became unstable, be it our jobs, businesses, work, our life, it's in chaos. While majority of our things in our lives become volatile, one thing has remained stable throughout, and that is hope. And hence today, the message of hope that comes from the resurrection of Christ become even more critical in the current time of crisis. Let me share my screen. Okay. And hence I title my message for today as the impact of resurrection in present times. The impact of resurrection in present times. And let me ask you something. What difference has the resurrection of Jesus Christ made in our life? What difference has it made? Now let me give you some pointers. What difference has it made in a way we think? In a way we live our life? What difference can people see? In our behavior, does it show the difference? In our conduct, do people see different conduct from us than rest of what they see from the rest of the world? Do they see difference in our conversation? In how we treat each other? In how we worship our God? What difference does it make in where we will be in eternity? And to answer this question, we need to firstly look into what we believe. What we believe? We believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and that He came to live with us on earth. We believe that He had died on the cross for the forgiveness of our sins. We believe that God has raised Him from dead. We believe that He had ascended in heaven and is seated next to God the Father. We believe that we have hope of eternal life in Him. And if I just summarize it, we are forgiven. And we are eternally secured in Him. Amen. We all believe this, right? Now answer the question. If our neighbor walks into our house and asks us, what difference has the message of resurrection made in our life? How would we answer? Now, when we firmly believe this, yet many times we or many other Christians who listen to and believe the message of resurrection, they still believe that our ticket to eternal life is the result of our conduct, that we have to work for our salvation every day of our life. We are still insecure. We still feel that it's the outcome of our action that will make us righteous with God. And somehow we feel we will live our life, the way we live our life will determine how we'll make the cut. And this all happens because we live in a very self-centric world. And let me explain you. This is how do I work and what result do I bring determines my worth in office. How I live my life shows my status in the society. What I wear shows what I think. And that's what they perceive me in my society. If I fail on any count, I am somehow suddenly unworthy. Similarly are the religions of the world, where we come first and the God comes next. We do this, then only the God of the other religions does that. But it's not the same in Christianity. It's different with Christ when we follow Christ. He did it first for us unconditionally. And in this relationship, our role is just to respond. So when it comes to Christ, it's not self-centric, but it is other-centric. And that's what written in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 to 9. For by grace you have been saved by faith. Nothing you did could ever earn this salvation. For it was the love gift from God that brought us to Christ. So no one will ever be able to boast, for salvation is never a reward for good works or human striving. So we are now convinced that when we follow Christ and when we are in Christ, the salvation is not the result of our work or of good work or of conduct, but it's a gift that he has given us so that we can be a part of their communion. So when we have this understanding, when we have this conviction, how should it then transform our lives? How should we live our life based on this understanding? And as it says in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 15 and 16, but as he who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct. Since it is written, you shall be holy, for I am holy. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Imagine, how can we ever match this standard? How do we match Jesus' standard? Even though we are sinful by nature, always falling short of his glory. And on top of that, how can we be holy in our conduct? And to answer that, let us jump right into the Old Testament and see what God meant when he says, holy, for I am holy. And turn with me to Ezekiel chapter 36 for verse 25 to 28. And I would encourage you after the service, when you sit down, you read from verse 22 until 29 to get the more details of this. And it says, God says, I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you shall be clean from all your uncleanness. And from all your idols, I will cleanse you. And I will give you a new heart and a new spirit. I will put within you, and I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. Next, verse 27, it says, and I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes and be careful to obey my rules. Verse 28, God says, you shall dwell in the land that I gave to your fathers, and you shall be my people, and I will be your God. Now, if we have to take this, what does this mean to us in today's context? And here is what it means. When we respond to Jesus and invite him in our lives to be our personal Savior and Lord, our bodies become his holy temple, where he resides, where his Holy Spirit resides in us, as per 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 19. And this Holy Spirit convicts and transforms our heart from our sins and reveals us the heart of God. The Holy Spirit convicts us and inspires us to do every effort to be in constant communion with our God, and thus making us holy. Making us holy is where we are in perfect communion with our God. And then God can say, they are my people and I am their God. In Hebrews chapter 10, verse 10 and 14 says, and Joshua read from 10 verses 17. So this is what is, let me take you back a bit. What is mentioned in Ezekiel is what is referred in Jeremiah chapter 31, and what is referred in Jeremiah chapter 31 is what is referred in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 15 and onward, what Joshua read today. And I want to read here Hebrews chapter 10, verse 10 and verse 14. By God's will, we are made holy through the offering of body of Jesus, the anointed ones, and for all time. With one perfect offering, Jesus has perfected forever those who are being made holy. So, in summary, Jesus with one perfect offering has made us perfect and holy forever. The burden of being holy, for he is holy, is not on us, but what he has done has made us holy. So that's one thing is sorted out. But then how do we make our conduct to reflect this reality? Because in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 15, Peter says, be holy in your conduct. Yeah. So what does that mean? How do we reflect that? Being holy in our conduct means to submit to every situation we are facing into Jesus' hand, and to have complete and unwavering faith in his abilities to get it done for us. It means that we rely on him to do it rather than we rely on our own humanly efforts to get it done. So when we present ourselves in this world, in our conduct, we rely on Christ to do it for us rather than we try to be righteous, we try to justify for each and everything. Now, being holy does not mean being sinless. No. Does not even necessarily mean being perfect. But being holy means it's a life that is totally committed to Jesus Christ. Being holy means a life that makes every attempt to live up to the word of God. Being holy means a life that has an absolutely genuine desire and an effort to be obedient to him. Being holy means a life that shows love in action as we care for others in giving and sharing. And testimony sharing is one of it. Life that is holy, sinless, probably not, but a godly life committed to God in every way. That is what God expects us to be holy. Holiness is God's goal for every one of us. My family, today God is saying, be thou holy in all your conduct. That's His goal for every one of us. And God knows that we are not capable of living such a holy life all by ourselves. And that's why in 1 John chapter 1 verse 9, He says, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Every time we think we have faltered, we just need to confess our sin and set up a parameter right there. And Christ, His grace, forgive us of our sins and cleanses us so that we can be again right on track to be holy. Because holiness is God's goal for every one of us. Amen. Now, when we experience and enjoy such a rich life, we need to share the source of our joy and our hope with people around us. When we ourselves have experienced how God's love transformed us, forgiven us of our sins, helping us to be holy, we cannot just keep this fact, the source of joy, just with us. We need to go out and share with people around us. God desired everyone to have such a fulfilled life. And it is our obligation to share this message of hope with the world. Look at people around you. The pandemic has shattered their every sense of worldly hope that they ever had on their status, wealth, job, happiness. And with this all things gone, they are now suddenly without any hope at all. Imagine just before last year, if you had a wealth, people all said, oh, my tomorrow is settled. My future is settled. If you have a well job, you said, oh, I have got the right status. If you have good amount of money, people say, oh boy, I am happy. I can buy anything that I want to. But since last year, when things have turned around, and when this very thing, the status, the wealth, the job, the happiness, is no more their target for hope. Now they are suddenly without any hope at all. And when their every avenue of worldly hope is destroyed, they are clueless about what will happen if they lose their life. Now that's another trouble. Now then there are also another set of people around us who are filled with their guilt, sin, sadness, sickness, unfruitfulness and burdened by their conscious feeling that they think they are not worthy for having any hope. And they term themselves as losers. And remember, I said this is very self-centric world. So people here decide their worth by what they do. And losers, by their own definition, they think they do not deserve forgiveness and hope. And same is constantly portrayed by many religions of the world today. These people feel that their relationship with their God is performance driven. If they are good, then only their God is good. And that is why we see increase in suicides, failed marriages, destroyed families, domestic abuse, rise in gun violence, rise in racism incidents, because everyone is trying to compensate and fill the void. Because they are all unaware that there is somebody called a triune God, a living God, who loved the world so much that He sent His only Son to bear their sin so that they may have forgiveness of their sin and their unworthiness through His sacrifice on the cross, and have a hope of everlasting life in communion with the triune God. My family, we need to desperately share the message of hope with them. Now you might feel, how can I share the gospel? I am not equipped. I don't know how to speak or even how to talk and what to talk. Some of us might say, it's too dangerous in our neighborhood. And the most frequent thing, reason that we use is, our country's laws does not allow us to preach. And the best justification I ever heard is from a local church member when someone said, we are not made for ministry. And I said, really? Did Jesus choose only a few and put in their hearts to go to the end of the world and share the gospel, while for the others to be just a good followers and remain in their own comfort zone? Do you think so? He divided the ministry. Okay, few of you, you go. Few of you, you remain comfortable in your comfort zone. No. Sharing the gospel is the ministry for every one of us. And the Holy Spirit that resides in us also equips us to share God's truth with others around us. And the Holy Spirit is with us all the time. We are never alone when we trust Jesus as our Savior. So what is God telling us today on this Resurrection Day? In the midst of all the chaos, violence, sickness, instability, political distress, we have a message of hope and the world desperately need to know. World desperately need to know. And if you care about somebody, you will share. And if they don't listen to our sharing of the message of hope, it's okay. It's not our responsibility other than to share. The onus is on the Holy Spirit to convict them. Our responsibility is to share, and their responsibility is to respond. Is it not that you and I did when somebody shared with us? What we did? We responded. And their responsibility today is to respond. We have a truth, and that we can't just keep to ourselves. We need to share. We need to reflect that truth in our conduct. And today, this message of hope is even more critical. Look at around you. People are desperately looking for hope. And as I conclude, I want to leave you all with this song about our justification in Him. And what a glorious day it is that gives us eternal hope and encouragement to share with the world around us.
One day when heaven was filled with His praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is He. The Word became flesh and the light shined among us, His glory revealed, living He loved me. Dying He saved me, and buried He carried my sins far away. Rising He justified freely forever. One day He's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. One day they led Him up Calvary's mountain. One day they nailed Him to die on a tree. suffering, anguish, despised and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is here. Hands that heal nations, stretched out on a tree, and took the nails for me. Far away, rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day.
One day the grave could conceal him no longer. One day the stone rolled away from the door. Then he arose over death he had conquered. Now is ascended, my Lord evermore.
Death could not hold him, the grave could not keep him rising again. Far away, rising, he justified freely forever.